If you think about it, salt is the foundation of our economy. Cities have been named in its legacy, wars fought over it, it's been taxed. It occurs naturally nearly everywhere on Earth. And at times it was even used as money itself. Think of the word salary. It comes from ancient Romans that paid soldiers partially in salt.
That's a political fact of life everywhere you look. If salt gets expensive, people get angry.
There are over 14,000 different uses for salt. And in 2021, the global salt market was worth over $13 billion. Now, the U.S. market is dominated by three big players, Morton Salt, Cargill, and Compass Minerals. And only one is publicly traded.
Because Harvey Salt is a distributor, we have the ability to procure salt from all the major salt suppliers.
So now we have a much more concentrated industry than we've had before.
Perhaps it's a response to how demand for salt has shifted through history.
This is an issue that affects everybody on a daily basis. What they eat, the power that they get, the roads that they drive on.
If too much salt permeates our environment, the effects can be dangerous. Here's how salt became one of the most game-changing minerals in the world. And what will happen if the world keeps getting saltier?
So in front of me, I have two different kinds of salt. We have Morton's table salt, and we have Cargill's Diamond Crystal brand de-icing salt. Both of these are 100% sodium chloride. The biggest difference is how they're processed. So for the table salt, this is food grade, so it needs to be refined for human consumption. Whereas the de-icing salt is not produced in food grade conditions, so you really wouldn't want to eat this.
And most plentiful of the ocean's treasures, salt can be taken from the sea.
Throughout history, most salt was harvested through saltwater evaporation of some kind, and eventually good old-fashioned mining methods. However, the salt on your dinner table, it most likely came from solution mining. Water is pumped into these underground salt beds, making artificial brines.
Without water, salt pretty much looks like this. But to get it to food grade, like this, we have to use another method.
Vacuum pan. So the artificial brine is then pumped back up into a facility above ground where heat, or both heat and a vacuum, evaporates the water, leaving the sodium behind.
This is also how the shape of the grain can change, like your finer table salt, or a coarser pink Himalayan salt, or even something super fancy, like this really flaky salt.
The market for salt doesn't start and end with food. Actually, most of the salt used or sold in the U.S. doesn't even come from vacuum pan.
We're seeing it's a slight decline in food use every year.
For example, in this chart, table salt isn't even explicitly identified, but somewhere between food processing and distributors like grocery stores, table salt is only some part of that 13% of the market. That might be because salt in the food industry was once even more important.
Provisions to last us on the long journey.
It was needed for preservation, not just to make food taste better.
There was very little food you could export without salt. Vegetables, meat, fish, it all needed salt. So you could not have an international economy if you didn't have salt.
It's packed for shipment to markets all over the world.
Thanks to refrigeration.
Don't worry about things souring and spoiling in summer.
And frozen food.
To electronic oven to defrost and heat it.
Demand has shifted dramatically to this.
The majority is de-icing salt,
which is about as prosaic a use as I could imagine.
Highway de-icing salts accounted for about 42% of the total salt consumed or sold in 2022.
This is the largest salt mine in the world.
De-icing salt, like what I have right here, primarily comes from rock salt.
And U.S. salt production is led by rock salt at 43% of the market in 2022. So it makes sense that most rock salt mined ends up as an ice melt product. And since the U.S. uses an estimated 20 million metric tons of salt on roads every year, governments take bids from a bunch of companies to buy in bulk.
The governments in the U.S. every year that need to buy large quantities of salt, companies like Compass Minerals or Morton Salt or Cargill will have to submit bids each year for volumes and prices. So for the salt companies, they can bid a fixed price, then they essentially take on the risk of can they deliver the salt for that price and still make a good profit?
If it doesn't snow, the phones do not ring. Salt only costs pennies per pound, but it costs dollars per bag to move it. It's very heavy.
And rock salt is at the lower end of the price scale for salt products, averaging $60 per bulk unit in 2022, compared to vacuum pan salts, averaging $230 per bulk unit. And that makes sense, right? The vacuum pan salt takes a lot more time, machinery, processing, you name it, to get to that food grade status. But the largest market for sodium chloride behind de-icing salts is chemical. It made up 39% of salt sales in 2022. Salt is needed to manufacture chlorine and caustic soda, which are then used to create products like household cleaners and plastics. So think back to this solution mining process and the artificial brine before it's processed. The chemical industry uses that artificial brine as a chemical feedstock. 40% salt in brine used in 2022, most of it, 91%, was used to make chemicals. And it's even cheaper than rock salt, averaging $8.50 per bulk unit.
Salt has a very low value to weight ratio, meaning you can't transport it that far to make it economically viable. So you can't really ship salt all around the world.
However, there is one slice of the salt market that relies on plenty of imports: solar salt. Solar salt made up only 8% of what was used or sold in 2022. As the name suggests, brines, including artificial brines, are organized into ponds that are left to evaporate in the sunlight. Where else is there more sunshine to make solar salt than somewhere a little closer to the equator?
It actually is less costly to bring it in from the Caribbean, where the warm waters there and the arid and windy climate are the most conducive to production of solar salt generated from seawater.
Solar salt is the biggest chunk of salt imports to North America by far.
We are adjacent to the Port of Baltimore. So that is where ocean-going vessels bring in the majority of water treatment salt, what we call solar salt. Water softener removes the hardness ions, which can develop scale inside the pipe. So a food processing plant, pharmaceutical facility, education market, K-12, hospitals, retirement communities, nursing homes, people that use a lot of water need to soften and condition that water.
Industries don't want hard water that could reduce the life of equipment. But the issue goes even deeper than that.
There is a fascinating tension with salt in the environment because we do need salt in our everyday lives. It's kind of like a Goldilocks type thing. Too much or too little, you just need the right amount.
Salty water can be dangerous. Freshwater getting saltier is a widespread problem in the US and globally.
The problem is, the groundwater is now nearly as salty as the ocean.
Some of the major rivers and streams in the world have been showing these increasing trends.
A third of the rivers have become more salty in the past 25 years. Why? Because salt is corrosive. Chloride corrodes metal.
It can affect the roads that we drive on. There's rebar metal structures that hold roads together. And when it interacts with that rebar, it can dissolve the rebar and then it causes the road to buckle.
The most obvious way salt enters the environment, the very same de-icing salts keeping our roads safe. They're estimated to cause anywhere from $800 to $3,300 in structural damage for every ton used, according to the EPA. Overall corrosion of U.S. transportation infrastructure costs are in the billions. Sodium chloride isn't even the only kind of salt. Mineral salts are abundant.
You know, we think about building up areas like with parking lots, pavements, buildings, and all that. And when they break down, they release salts because there's calcium and carbonate that's used to make the built environment. It breaks down, releasing salts into the environment, which can affect water quality.
That backwashing salt water would flow through the limestone and ruin millions of rich producing acres.
Imagine metal pipes with saltier water flowing through.
And it goes through a whole labyrinth of pipes to homes. That salty water can interact with the pipes and mobilize more metals.
Water with more chlorides is going to leach metal from the wall of the pipes, making the water corrosive. this can create what the EPA calls salt chemical cocktails.
What happens is it can't be removed from the water treatment plant. Instead, they try to treat it as best as they can. People are taking it more seriously now because they've seen evidence of these leaching phenomenons.
See what the pipes are producing. In Flint, Michigan, dangerous levels of lead were discovered.
Flint River, it was a complicated issue, but they had switched their water to the Flint River, which had elevated chlorides and corrosivity.
The buildup of salt can cause a phenomenon called the freshwater salination syndrome.
We might experience in our everyday life corrosion of a home appliance, a road falling apart, our pipe running rusty black water. We do take the impacts of salt with a grain of salt, and we don't know, you know, all the impacts yet.
The EPA says freshwater salination syndrome is not easily remedied. So salt can be a problem, but it can also be a solution. For example, other salts are being used instead of sodium chloride, like calcium chloride and potassium chloride. They're substitutes for de-icing salts, but right now they come at a higher cost.
We've seen significant increases in the amount of ice melter that we have sold with fewer chlorides in it versus straight rock salt, which has a significant amount of chlorides in it.
Innovation is happening to make salt more eco-friendly.
You know, then we're also seeing new products go into de-icing salt. I think part of the innovation that allows a coating of salt to stay on the road longer, part of that does reduce the runoff that goes into the water. You know, so when salt companies are innovating to use, say, pre-storm salt versus having to wait till it snows and then salting the roads, a lot of that pre-storm salt is an upgraded product that can last through an entire storm versus having to put two or three or four layers of salt down on the roads. That likely leads to less salt being, you know, run off in the waterways.
And some cities are figuring out how to use less salt. Turns out less is more.
And I mean, we have a lot of dedicated people trying to reduce salt in the environment, and they're cognizant of the problem. I mean, people weren't completely aware of this issue like over the last decades, but as more and more research has come out, they've become more aware and they're really trying the best that they can.
It's hard to imagine a world without salt, especially increasing severe weather that may result in more road salt to keep drivers safe.
In years when there are heavy winters and there's a lot of snow, we do see salt prices tend to rise. But when there's winters that are very mild, the salt producers tend to have excess inventory that they couldn't sell because nobody buys salt when it's not snowing. When that happens, we see prices tend to fall.
Salt was immensely critical in shaping the world we live in today.
A slab of rock salt, transparent crystal cubes, and the kind you use on your table.
So it's no surprise that salt could transform the world ahead of us, too.
It's funny because I have a son and you watch these movies like WALL-E, right?
The Lost Robot on Earth.
It's a cute movie where it talks about how Earth is polluted and people have to move off of it for a while. By thinking about how we develop versus conservation can really do future generations a lot of good, because the more we develop, the saltier the water is going to get.